ABC is an equilateral triangle. The vertex A has got a velocity u naught towards the vertex B. The vertex C has a velocity in the direction of BC, but its magnitude is not stated. The point of the problem is to figure the magnitude and direction of the velocity of the vertex B. The general motion of a rigid object like this can be thought of as the linear motion of the center of mass plus a rotation about the center of mass. Now the two of these can be put together and thought of as a pure rotation about an axis passing through this point. Now that's called the instantaneous axis of rotation. This is the fastest way to solve this problem, because once we have a point somewhere about which it's just going to rotate, from the axis of rotation we would know how the velocity should look like, and using that we could figure out what is the velocity of the vertex B. The second way to do it is to look at the relative velocity. Because this is a rigid object, the distance between A and B cannot change. Therefore, A and B cannot have a relative velocity along the line joining them. Because if they had a positive velocity, it would mean that this distance is increasing. If they had negative velocity, then it would mean that this distance is decreasing. So neither of them can happen because it's a rigid object. And therefore, there should be no relative velocity along AB. Similarly, along AC and BC. Third way of looking at the same problem, it's not a new method, but that's the most general way of writing the velocity of any point on this rigid object. And that's the velocity of A is the center of mass velocity plus the velocity due to rotation about the center of mass. So this vector is from the center of mass to the point A. Now we could assume a certain velocity to the center of mass and an unknown omega and write it out for all the points A, B and C and try to solve this. Alternatively, we could also get the velocity of the point B in terms of the velocity of the point A plus rotation about the point A if it's omega cross AB vector. This is not essentially a new method. These are all similar methods. However, this is the fastest way to solve this problem. Try it out. Let's first look at the instantaneous axis of rotation. If this object is rotating about some axis through this plane, then a vector from that instantaneous axis to any point on this object is just a rotation. Therefore, if the rotation is in this direction, then that point can only have a velocity that is perpendicular to the vector joining from the instantaneous axis to that point. Alternatively, if we know the direction of the velocity, then we just need to draw a line perpendicular to that velocity, and the axis should lie somewhere on that line. Because remember, there is only pure rotation about that axis. There is no linear motion. If we look at the vertex A, the velocity of A is along this direction, and therefore the axis must be perpendicular to it. So it must be somewhere along that direction. It can be on either sides, therefore we have to extend it on either sides. This angle out here is 90 degrees. Similarly, with the vertex C, the direction of its velocity is known and therefore it must be perpendicular. Once the perpendicular from C is drawn, we know that this point of intersection must be the instantaneous axis of rotation. Because it's an equilateral triangle, we know that the extended altitude must pass through this instantaneous axis of rotation. We also know all the angles in this figure. So the angle there being 30 degrees. Let us say the side of the triangle is 2a. Then the height of the triangle is going to be a root 3. Then this distance below out here, that would be related by tan 30. Tan 30 would be this height divided by a. And therefore, this must be a by root 3. You can also get the distance out here. That is a divided by cos 30. and that is A divided by cos 30, that is root 3 by 2. So we have all the distances. Now we are going to use the fact that there's a pure rotation about this point. If it's a pure rotation, then this velocity must be this distance, perpendicular distance, into omega. Velocity of the point A must be omega into the distance, which is 2a divided by root 3. Also, because this distance is exactly same as that distance, the velocity of C must be same as the velocity of A. Therefore, we already discovered that this velocity must be u naught. So velocity of the point B must be equal to the omega into the distance. The distance is a root 3 plus a by root 3. We know that the velocity of the point A is u naught, and therefore omega is a known quantity. Therefore, the velocity of the point B is root 3 times u naught divided by 2a into a 3 plus 1 divided by root 3. And that looks like 2 times u naught. The direction is obvious because this is the axis of rotation out here. The velocity must be perpendicular to the line from the axis of rotation, and therefore this velocity is 2 times u naught. We'll now use the concept of relative velocity being zero along the line joining any two points on a rigid object. So it's easier to look at AC first. If we were to drop a perpendicular from the velocity, then the component of the velocity in this direction must be u naught cos 60. This angle is 60 degrees. Cos 60 is half, therefore it's u naught by 2. Along the line AC, C2 should have the same component, and therefore if we drop a perpendicular from its velocity to the line AC, then the magnitude of this must also be u naught by 2. This angle being 60 degrees, this has to be u naught. Now let's look at AB. Along the line joining A and B, there can be no relative velocity. Therefore, B2 should have a velocity u naught along the direction AB. Similarly, along the line BC, B must have a velocity u naught. These two are the components of the velocity of the vertex B. The actual velocity of the vertex B, let it be in some direction, and let's call it some u. We could call those angles alpha and beta. But the component of u along this direction and the component along this direction should match up. Therefore, we see that alpha must be equal to beta. Therefore, this line out here, this must be horizontal. This must be the velocity u. And now we know that once it's horizontal, we know that this angle must be 60 degrees. We should get a component of u naught if we drop a perpendicular out here. And therefore, this must be u naught divided by cos 60, which is going to give 2 u naught. So that's the direction and magnitude of the velocity of the vertex B. This is not a totally new way, but this holds in general. We could assume a velocity to the center of mass in some direction, an x component, y component, and carry out this calculation by assuming an unknown omega. However, it's easier to see this graphically, and let's use the second equation. So how should the velocity of B be? It should have a velocity of A, and therefore it should have a vector in the direction of AB. That must be u naught. Plus a rotation term. Now, if it rotates about the point A, then that gives rise to a rotational velocity in that direction. That must be omega into the length of the side, that is 2a. The sum of these two velocities must be the final velocity of the vertex B. Let's apply the same idea to the vertex C. Due to the velocity v naught, vertex C should also have a velocity u naught. Due to rotation, it must have a velocity in the downward direction. That's the rotation about the point A, due to that rotation, it must have a velocity in the downward direction. Its magnitude 2 should be omega into the distance. The distance is 2a. If we add these two vectors, we should get a vector along this direction. So let's bring it to the point here. It should be parallel to u naught, so it's some vector outlet. So this is the vector u naught. Therefore, we have to extend this. So sum of omega 2a plus u naught must be in this direction because that's a given quantity. Now, if you look at the angles at C, this angle is 30 degrees and this angle also is 30 degrees because that's the angle it makes with the vertical out here. The horizontal angle out there, this angle is 60 degrees and therefore that must be 30 degrees. This is 30 degrees, that also is 30 degrees. This now is an isosceles triangle and therefore these two must be identical. Therefore, the velocity of the vertex C is u naught. Also from this, we see that this component must be 2 times u naught into cos 30, which is root 3 by 2. Therefore, omega into 2a is root 3 times u naught. Take it back to the point here. Therefore, this is root 3 times u naught. The angle between them is 90 degrees. Magnitude of the velocity of vertex B should just be u naught square plus root 3 times u naught whole square, which is 2 times u naught. That's the resultant. The angle it's going to make with this axis out here is going to be, call it some theta, then tan theta is given by u naught divided by root 3 times u naught, which is 1 by root 3, implying that theta is 30 degrees. So if theta is 30 degrees, then this line must be horizontal. There we have it. The velocity of B is horizontal and the magnitude is 2 times u naught.